up. We are very pleased to have with us today Soenke Lorenzen, media analyst at Greenpeace International. Soenke is a visiting researcher in New Media and Digital Culture, Media Studies, University of Amsterdam, this semester. And he is also pivotal in organizing our very own digital methods winter school and data sprint. The practitioners, the critical practitioners who will be speaking have been sourced by Soenke from such organizations as Tick, 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 The Alerts, Some of Us, UNICEF, places like this. And we're very, very pleased to have Soenke here to give us a sort of introduction into media monitoring. As I mentioned earlier in this class, media monitoring, you could say, is one of the seminal forms of media analysis. So you're studying new media analysis. It's one of the most basic foundational or seminal forms. And Soenke is going to tell us about that. So would you please join me in welcoming Soenke? Welcome. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks for having me here. So maybe to give you a little bit of background on Greenpeace or Greenpeace International. Greenpeace is an organization which is active in quite a number of countries from Latin America to Asia. Greenpeace International doesn't really have the function of a head office. It's more of an advisory body. We've been managing a lot of the international campaigns, advising national offices on their communications, campaigning, et cetera. Greenpeace International also manages the ships. You might have been aware of the Arctic 30 activity we had, which was quite important to have such a body as Greenpeace International to manage all the legal issues around it, the communications, et cetera, because, for example, if you're working outside or inside the Russian office, you have very different things to deal with if you have 30 international activists in jail in Russia. Maybe just as an example, the Russian office was very keen, for example, not to message anything negative about Putin during that time, whereas a lot of offices, that's the first thing they actually had on their mind, was actually to, go right into the political, and that would have had quite massive consequences. Even a wrong tweet could have actually kind of changed the whole process. So just to show you the importance of managing media internationally. And when I talk about media, I don't really make a difference between social media or online news media or print media, because it's kind of all merging together in some form or another, depending where you're in, what country or what media landscape you're working in. What I'm going to give you is just a little bit of general context on how we work internally with Greenpeace International, but as also a lot of national offices would do. It's quite similar, actually, with a lot of other NGOs. They work in similar ways. They have access to the same tools, or sometimes actually less access to these tools, depending on their budgeting, etc. So these are also important issues. Because one thing we found, actually, when also looking at the winter school, one thing that's actually missing for NGOs is a free tool to actually aggregate news media. All of these are pretty much in hands of commercial entities. Take Salesforce, Radiant 6, Meltwater. These are online news aggregators. Come back to that later. Something I'm often actually asked about, and I've been working with Greenpeace for almost 10 years, is, why monitor? A lot of people tell me, I know what I want to message. I have my message here. I'll just send it out to anyone who wants to hear it. But actually, to create more targeted messaging, you really have to take into account all the different sequences. For example, you start off with your planning in general, your communications planning. You start doing your research on information. Who do you want to target? You want to know what type of feedback are you getting from the media, or even also on social media commentary. And in the end, you need to evaluate your campaign. And this doesn't have to happen actually at the end of a campaign. It's actually a continuing process when you have to can adjust your messaging while you're going along. Like I just said, for the example of the Arctic 30 is one of those. You actually have to see how the media is reacting to certain things, what are they picking up, is it correct what they're picking up, etc. So there's kind of a strategic framework for this. If you look at this, it's a bit small maybe, but things to consider, your key actors identified in a power analysis. This is usually done in the very early stages, actually, already of campaign planning. You need to figure out how you want to message to the different actors. Then you want to know what kind of platforms you want to use. Platforms could be, for Greenpeace especially, are you going to do an action? What type of messaging will go along with that? What kind of visuals will you generate? Via which channels, which news channels, social media platforms, etc. Some countries don't really have access to Facebook. You have to think of other platforms like Weibo or RT in Russia. Finally, the result or the action of your communications. Something that's also changed in the past years is the communication life cycle. It's actually 24/7. The traditional news cycle doesn't exist anymore, so it's constant messaging all over the world, different time zones. So what we want to do in that communication life cycle, establishing awareness of the issue, building sufficient knowledge and understanding about the issue, and then the next stage would be actually create some kind of interest to actually get people react, or finally maybe a change of behavior, intent or commitment to take a specific action. This could be anything from actually just retweeting a post or signing a petition. So effective communications, we've done this one, So it's actually a constant cycle. I've kind of touched on this before research the media, contact the media, monitor the coverage, and evaluate the results. So this can happen in a 24-hour cycle as we're having it now with the typhoon in the Philippines. Our international director left, I think, 3 days ago for the Philippines to be there to meet the ex-negotiator from the Philippines and to bring out strong messaging to the COP20 in Lima. So you can see it's pretty much interconnected. You have to think, if you know your actors at the COP, specific politicians, you have somebody from the Philippine negotiating team there, and to connect the issue of the typhoon with the messaging at the COP. So what is media analysis? Very generally speaking, success of your communications activity. What we use mostly is, and what's far more important than just the quantitative analysis, is the qualitative analysis. So it's pretty much content analysis. We want to see, we have to identify the, well, I won't go into too much detail here, actually, but we have to be very clear about your audiences. I think this is actually something that is very often missed, that certain audiences only will receive information via specific channels. So you have to figure out on Twitter, how do you, if you want to communicate with the political sphere, that's actually quite a key one, let's say the COP20. To actually research the different Twitter handles of negotiators, of politicians attending, etc., to actually echo those or influence those. won't go into this. Audience analysis. And we have, depending on, and that's pretty much one of the key issues which exemplifies the gap between academics and practitioners. In the practice side, we never have time. Everything has to be done yesterday. So I get a lot of these requests. I need a qualitative analysis of our audiences. And could you do that in the next couple of hours? Usually I have to say, well, it's a bit short. So I know that in academia, you might have a whole year to research an issue like that. And we have to do it all week. So that's a real challenge. You have to know where to find that information. And it's not always readily available. You might have just limited information on certain audiences, media landscapes, as they're also constantly changing. That's why it's also important to keep, at least for us at Greenpeace International, to keep in close contact with the different offices, because they are aware, possibly, of issues within their own media landscape, which we are not, because this, even that information may not be available through research at the moment. Even, like I would say, practitioner research from PR companies, it takes a while also for them to actually update their research as well. So that's kind of similar. So some of it is actually, if you get it 70% right, that's enough for us, and off we go. Something we haven't really done a lot, because when we look at the coverage that Greenpeace gets internationally, the tone of the coverage, we know that in most countries it's pretty positive in general, or at best kind of balanced. So we receive very little negative coverage, and when we do, we actually know where it comes from. There's certain media landscapes which are quite difficult to communicate in. This is due to political issues and also issues around the media landscape in that country. Example would be Australia, with a very strong centered media industry around the Murdoch conglomerate. Very conservative media in combination with a conservative government doesn't really make for very positive media coverage, on our issues at least. Same goes actually by now for Canada, which is actually where Greenpeace was founded, but we're having quite a difficult time there. Whereas maybe a positive example would be Germany, where Greenpeace is a very established voice, and in the media it's kind of the go-to organization for any kind of issues around the environment. So. So a bit more of general context. I kind of mentioned this already. If you look at the international picture, and it's actually quite difficult to assess this, how well do we perform media-wise internationally? I've been working with my team on creating a huge list of links which we monitor. We call it our global tier one media list, which is by country adapted to the most important media sources or news sources. That can be, like for the Netherlands, you wouldn't just look at traditional print outlets and their web presence, but you would also look at news platforms like nu.nl, for example. Whereas in other countries, the only possibility you may have, like in Vietnam, is to watch pretty much the news or the online news outlets from the major papers, which are all state-owned. So you actually know beforehand already that you're looking at a very biased news space. Interesting study I found some years ago. It's maybe a bit outdated, but it can give you kind of an idea. This is kind of a world map of the distribution of major global of media firms. So what is the density of media firms in major cities? And these are all pretty tightly connected as well. So if you look at the Americas, we have New York, Los Angeles. For Europe, we have London, Amsterdam, which might seem a bit strange because there's no real international news outlets here, but there's quite a few global communication firms which are set here, more on the more ad agencies, etc. We have here Berlin, that's more for political one, Brussels, etc. And then in Asia, you can see this, what they identified as alpha world media cities. You actually don't have any, although I would probably say that Hong Kong has evolved to be one. But again, looking at the political situation in Hong Kong at the moment, there's some drawbacks, obviously, also on free communication in that in Hong Kong. So it's possibly also not the best geographic location at the moment. Singapore is also quite a fast-growing one, although the political situation is also quite difficult there. When you talk about Singapore, they don't really care if you talk about any other country as much. So you can see this, it's very dense. So if you're trying to talk about international coverage, I tend to say this, there are no international media outlets. There might be one or two exceptions, but even looking at CNN, they actually adapt their content by region. So what you might see for CNN in Asia is not the same as you would see in Europe or in the US. So actually, the stories are already adapted to the media landscape they're broadcasting in. I can go into maybe a little bit of that change of editorial control. In the past, we always had the editors pretty much being the gatekeeper for the news. This has pretty much changed, as you know. It's pretty much the audiences controlling the content. Here's an example from the BBC where the audience actually picks their own favorites, and you probably know that also from Facebook. It's not really, I would say, the breaking news, political news, but it's more the tabloid style. So what we have here, jokes, sex, yeah, that's pretty much the top themes being picked by the audiences. So it's kind of a difficult one to talk about climate change and policies, etc. That's, yeah, tough one to get in there with your messaging. A lot of news outlets have used monitoring system themselves on their websites to actually see how they can actually adapt all of their news to the audience. So it's not so much the editor saying this is what the audience needs to know, this is just what the audience wants to know, at least from their statistics. It's an example coming from Chile, whereby adapting that kind of strategy, it's a bit outdated, but I think you would probably see their average circulation rise even further. This is for online, the online entities. It just shows by constantly monitoring your stories and adapting them, you pretty much take the lead. Another one is the mix between print, online, and mobile. It's an interesting stat coming from Japan, from Asahi Shimbun, one of the biggest newspapers globally. Actually, I think four of the biggest ones globally by circulation are from Japan. So newspaper, this is the age distribution, picks up the biggest share, that's above age of 50. For the online version, you can see the green part in the middle, that's about age group 30 to 50, and mobile is actually under 30. So very clear age focus, depending on which platform you're using to disseminate your news. Yeah, and as I just mentioned, it's the control, the traditional control was pretty much one way. It was broadcasting to whoever can be reached. And nowadays, it's more of a social consumption, distributed mediation, syndication, etc., going via podcasts, wikis, forums, blogs, etc. How much time do we have left? Well, we got what? Got a bit, yeah. Because I wanted to also keep some time so for some Q&A. Journals and channels. We have news features, reporting stories, interviews, and commentary. They reach very different types of audiences, and the quality of the content is also quite important. What we've been focusing on a lot when it comes to political communications is actually commentary. Commentary is maybe sometimes a bit undervalued. It's difficult to assess. Well, the commentary function has been kind of split. Traditionally, still, you have a lot of news commentary only in print or print that you can access online. For example, the Wall Street Journal commentary is quite key for us in tracking certain political developments, whereas commentary, let's say, in social media is non-relevant really to us, unless it's on a broader scale. If we're trying to engage with a more consumer-related issue, let's say toxics in clothing, that's where it actually, the commentary functions in social media kind of takes the lead. Interesting is also because we have mobile in here. We have the genres, for example, for news and mobile. That's a big issue in two regions. One is Africa, because a lot of people actually access their news via their mobiles. That's even with so-called dumb phones. So you don't need a smartphone to actually receive news tidbits. You can actually get them via text messaging. And we've been working with that also in India quite successfully, of direct messaging via mobile phones. You can reach really millions of people in just one go with mobiles, far, far better than using online news media and obviously print media as well. And I haven't really talked about broadcast that much, although broadcast, I would say, in some countries is still absolute key. But depending, again, on the media landscape, the space for actual news is quite limited. Maybe taking, as an example, Italy, where a lot of broadcasts, I would say the quality is more entertainment, or the tendency is more to cover mostly entertainment, broadcasts, and the news media is pretty much, I would say, to a large extent, controlled by one or two entities. And this kind of monopoly situation always reduces the possibility to message issues around environmental or climate change, etc., these kind of issues. And what we have as well, I mean, that's maybe also quite something we've been trying to work with in the past years is the advancement of multimedia storytelling. It's quite an interesting one because it allows us, for example, because we're very visual in our communications often, also especially if you're using actions, to actually tell stories using videos online, YouTube, etc., and also slideshows, to incorporate those into kind of microsites. So actually not always centering on our own website, but actually creating, yeah, microsites, which is more effective. Sometimes they're not branded as well, so the viewer does not actually at first glance know, oh, it's Greenpeace, which kind of also creates extra interest, more focused on the issue than on the actual creator of the messaging. Maybe something also which I think is important in this case, NGOs have become kind of news broadcasters in themselves, but actually if I look at our web analytics, it's quite sobering, because if you look at the access or how our blogs perform, I would say, I mean, taken that we have over 1 million likes of our Facebook site just for international, a good blog might just reach about 200 views. So that's probably something that's quite overvalued within the organization, to think that we have to create a blog for every single press release we send out. The other thing which is may also be quite surprising is that the front page of our website also is actually not the most accessed. It's actually people access the website sideways. And the most interesting subjects are usually jobs and history. Almost everything else is, well, I would say, is really underperforming. And that's an issue that I think most NGOs have. So the kind of shows a bit the dependency of echoing all of these messages in the news media, on online media. I won't go into these timing things. No, I think I'll keep it at that on content. What I would like to show you maybe is the tools that we're using and how they integrate into a tool that we've been building internally. And I hope it still works now. As I said, news aggregation is pretty much in hands of commercial entities. One of the companies we've started using is TalkWalker. Actually, all of these companies and their dashboards, they look pretty similar and they work in very similar ways. They pretty much extract the news from the websites directly, so they don't use the feeds from the websites. And I have to say, I compared a lot of these commercial systems, and actually every system finds other news. So to actually figure out how much news is there is also quite a challenge. I found, for example, that comparing Google News with a system like this one, and I think we used at the time also a company called Meltwater, that Meltwater and this system, they each found about 80% of what the other one found. That means about 40% of the coverage was not found by either of them, which is quite a lot, actually, if you think about it. And Google News found about 40% of what either of them found. But this is mostly due to Google News having a very limited coverage on news outlets as soon as it leaves the English language. You might be aware in Germany, even some outlets were actually kind of not banned, but the content was not distributed anymore by Google because of a lawsuit they had of Google actually disseminating links, which they found was already a breach of copyright, and they actually won that law case in Germany. So that was media companies actually wanting to keep their own content, but they found that their traffic to their own news website actually went down by about 20 to 30% because of that. So now that they won, they actually granted Google again access without paying. So these systems. You can see on the left-hand side, these are kind of the Boolean search profiles that we've set up. So you're looking here at the IPCC and the Typhoon, which are mapped out. At the bottom, you can see the new stream. I think we'll just seeing. So that we haven't selected any specific media. This kind of covers online news media, Twitter, Facebook, almost anything. We also have a number of lists that we've created, which you can use as a filter at the top. I'll show you. So if we open these filters, you can actually filter by media type, country, language. Usually a better filter I've found is actually language online, especially when it comes to Twitter. As you know, geotagging doesn't actually work that well, because as soon as it's not specified, by default it goes to the US. So it's easier to actually do that by language. Also because I've seen that if you have, for example, content coming out of Spain, it by default gets echoed in Latin America. So it travels a lot. A lot of news just travels by default via language. We've seen activities, for example, in the DRC, Democratic Republic of Congo, by default being covered not just in Belgium, because they have very close ties, but also in France in general and in Switzerland, which creates certain opportunities if you're aware of that. On the right side, you can actually see it says all sources, and that's where we've created specific lists which we can filter these results by. So let's say if I only take our list that I mentioned before, which contains about 1,000 different web links globally, it changes drastically the numbers. What is interesting, that also the shares change. So you can see in these top media outlets, it's obviously not the IPCC and COP really taking the lead as an issue, but it's actually the Typhoon. And you can also see it probably be interesting if I can split this now by, I'll split it by country in this case, because Twitter is not included now in this search. See if it works, yeah. So what I can see immediately, well, US by default, oh. We can't see it very well, but you can see the top shares in coverage coming from the Philippines, Germany, Spain, but these are already at around 4%. We can see that the most of the coverage actually does come from US entities, so on this one. Another interesting function of this specific system is that I, for each story, like the Wall Street Journal, I can see a number of extra metrics of exactly this story, which is the Twitter shares, the Facebook shares, and the Facebook likes. That actually is something I haven't seen before, and we haven't quite used that yet, but it does show the prominence of a story. A good example of how this can be used, our office in Mexico, they say that most people actually don't access news websites because they're all more or less behind paywalls. So they just, most people consume their news via Facebook. So for them, it's far more important to know if a story is getting traction on Facebook or being shared there or liked than actually looking, at the website itself, like La Jornada or something. So what we've done at Greenpeace, I've built with a colleague of mine, we've built a system. It's a dashboard, yeah. What we've done from these monitoring systems, we get feeds from them, which we input into our own analysis system, and we can add in our system keywords, etc. So that's what my team does, and we're also working on kind of automated tagging of articles to create stats, and they would pretty much look something like maybe not. I can't show this because I think I have to. This is all on a, it's on a VPN system. So it's an, it's on our internal servers. Just have to log in again. Yeah, it's a, this is actually also quite an interesting one because doing this is quite a gray zone. Like for us as an organization, if we store news stories on our server, and as long as we don't disseminate them or third parties don't have access, it's not a breach really of copyright. Maybe it is, but at least not one that can be seen outside. Whereas if we would kind of start disseminating single stories, we'd probably be sued right away because that would be seen as a commercial activity. Okay, let me see if it, I can try this again. Yeah, okay, now it's working again. So just to show you how it would work. Mm-hmm. This is kind of a test server. We haven't been working with this version, but I thought it was because I wanted to show something else as well, how we can use different data sets. Yeah, kind of something like that. So what we're trying to do is that we can filter then by the different campaigns and keywords, and the user can actually also just select the time frame. What we're trying with this system is to enable our press officers or anyone who needs certain quantitative information or analysis can actually do it themselves without starting to work in a more complex dashboard like I've shown you before, because that would use an extra lot of training and time. So this information was ready kind of pre, somebody already worked on it, and you can actually then filter, yeah, by the specific issues you're working on. The interesting thing that what we are trying to do is add to this information by also looking at issues around maybe from our actions unit. They have put in data on where actions took place and when. So which, you can probably not, it's a world map. Further down at the bottom, it's kind of split then by the time. So the idea is actually to see where are we getting the same, are we getting extra media attention by having an action which was done at a certain time? And how effective was that, and what issue was it connected to? So we can overlay these types of data streams. So that's more of a general evaluation one, but you could also use that within a very short time frame, within hours, to actually see we've started this action, and now let's look at the media coverage of that. Is it contained within that country where it took place? Is it getting more international traction, et cetera? And the way we actually get the media data in here is just by RSS feeds. So we get the feed from the other platform I showed you going into the system, and we're using different monitoring systems to feed in data. And the system actually recognizes if it's a duplicate URL, and then it actually just does away with that one if it's a new one coming in. That's one way to avoid duplication in the system as well. And maybe what I'll show you a bit is how, what we do when we actually,
Maybe you can show how you set up a campaign.
Let me see if I could show it in this system. I'll do it in a different one. So this is the search function, but actually when my team actually adds the metadata to each article, they pretty much have the same selection. So what they do when they get the article, they identify pretty much just the keyword, potentially a rating of the tone, so negative, slightly negative, etc. They identify the weight of the mention, so is it more a side mention or is it an exclusive article where Greenpeace is mentioned in the headline? What is the actual source within the article? Is it a wire or does it come from a specific journalist? We keep track of that. Or is it trying to connect our journalist database that we have, which we use to send out press releases, directly to this system so that you can actually search for a journalist and automatically get all the articles that he wrote about us. What else do we have here? The type of distribution. A lot of this actually is done already automated. What we have in the background is a media list, and that media list already just by the URL identifies what media type it is, what type of orientation it has. Is it conservative? Is it an economic outlet, or what type of distribution is it online? We have one or two offices which also add their broadcast media coverage to the system. That's done via their own national media monitoring company. We can actually identify audiences. That's something we're working on at the moment. So we're trying to identify what type of audience is typical for that outlet and how we potentially can connect to it. So once we've done that, let me see if I just do a generic search. Yeah, this is pretty much, I can see we have 260 articles in the past 24 hours. So this is kind of, I could now type in, for example, a keyword. Oops. These are the articles as they're shown.
So each of those mentioned Greenpeace?
In this case, yes. But we've also started setting up searches for other issues. Maybe not climate change, because that would kind of be heavy on the system, but more specific ones. For example, for the COP20, we have a stream coming in. But at the moment, actually, we're using the other platform to analyze issues. And we're kind of experimenting if we can see, because we only have a team of four people. They can't kind of tag thousands of articles a day. So we're trying to figure out if they're automated systems, text analysis systems, which can kind of identify tags or create tags themselves. There's a number of, most of them are by now commercial, but we also know that from the digital methods, there's a number of tools that you could actually link to that. So that's actually what we're working with as well. Maybe just to show you, I mean, once the data is in there, And we can always create new tags. The question was, how do we set up a campaign? If we know that we're going to do a very in-depth qualitative analysis, we just add a bunch of extra tags. We have an extra column just on framing. So if the key frames that we have identified, we put them in there. So by each article, we say which frames are mentioned and which keywords. And then we can connect with that. And yeah, an analysis would kind of give you geographic distribution, time distribution by campaign. You can see campaign mentions by share, by source, etc. So major mentions, side mentions. So in the last 24 hours, yeah, quite a lot of side mentions actually, 70%. We actually have a general average share of about 30%. This probably has to do with the COP, where probably Greenpeace will be quoted alongside a number of other organizations. Yeah. Do we have some time for questions? I'm pretty much, yeah, I'm done.
Thanks very much. So, you have the opportunity to ask the media analyst from Greenpeace International anything you like. Anybody? Can I start then? So, what I found fascinating is that you monitor every single mention that you get. So I have three brief questions. The first one is the role of media monitoring at Greenpeace. So if you get a lot of coverage, does that constitute a success, or what are the other factors? So what if there's lots of coverage and no social change? That's the CNN effect. It seems as if there's a lot happening because there's lots of coverage, but there's no change.
Yeah.
Or that there's very little coverage, but there is change. Okay, so what's the relationship between, that's number one. And the second one, and maybe this is sensitive or something, but I can imagine that I'm a campaigner at Greenpeace and I think I'm doing a great job, but I'm not getting that much coverage. So is this information that you provide something that creates tensions? I mean, in other words, this is not a question to put you in the spotlight too much, but it's more like, how important is media monitoring in Greenpeace to determine what it is that you do and you don't do, and determines what's a success and what's not a success?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you get a lot of, well, usually if things run well, you don't get feedback. If they don't, you do. And the first go-to person is very often me, because people said, oh, but I've seen so many mentions of my campaign on the internet. So we come back to, what's the quality of that coverage? Did you actually, get coverage from where it matters? So maybe a good example would be something we did quite a while ago, but we've done it for a lot of years, to look at, I think it was about cloud computing and how green is cloud computing. And the target audience there was not the general public, because we know that in some countries, like the US, when they actually did a poll on do you know what cloud computing is and does the weather have any effects on it, actually about half the people said they think it does. So the target audience here was obviously the industry. And what we actually tried to do is to see now, since you're key target of the campaign was to actually create a conversation in the industry about green cloud computing using renewables in building their what do you call it, server farms, actually what we found is they didn't really care. It wasn't an issue, even after 6 months of campaigning. Although one or two companies like Salesforce, and I think at the time, I don't know if it was Google or I think or Amazon, either one of them also built one in a clean one in Scandinavia. But these are kind of a bit of greenwashing, I would say, because most of their server farms are actually not green. So what we actually found out in our analysis was, if I look at the campaign strategy, I look at the communication strategy, and these are the people you want to target, well, somehow they just didn't listen. We can prove that quite clearly. Why didn't they listen? Maybe because we didn't get enough traction, but that's difficult with an issue which is so small and not really of any public interest. So in that case, yeah, I need a lot of explaining. But on the other hand, I can always point back to their own communication strategies, their own campaign strategies. So if you've thought that this could work, why didn't it work? Because you don't have enough connections in the industry, not enough clout to actually make a change in that industry. So these are the things that they would have to think about when adapting a new strategy if they want to continue with that campaign. Sometimes it also just goes by chance. Obviously, campaigns are won by just threatening that we'll campaign, and companies will say, we'll change. Numbers, I don't really, I mean, it's on the very big picture, it's kind of important to look at these trends, but in actually evaluating a specific campaign, it's not so much the numbers, it's really the context. Did our messages get through? And what is the influence of that source? And how does it connect? I would say like our forests campaign, they don't get a lot of traction. But if you have an editorial in the Wall Street Journal and a piece in the Financial Times, we know that these companies are very concerned of being mentioned in these sources. And I would already say, well, that's a success. You got two articles, but so influential that, probably that's enough. You don't actually need all of that extra other coverage because it's not as influential. If you get 1,000 likes on Facebook, these companies who are not in the news media in general, they're very much in the background, like Dancer, you probably never heard of, the Swiss company, which kind of is cutting down half the rainforest in the DRC, they don't care because they're not, they don't depend on positive coverage in the media, except in the economic media. So in that side, they don't want any disturbances because of their shareholders. So yeah, it really depends, yeah.
Any other questions?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Was it the German domain? I don't know. It was 2000. But it was a report about the Sarko Park.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And how it's
it had cracks and they didn't have the money to repair it. And I mean, we can't make these connections on an international level. On a national level, I think our German office is pretty good, especially analyzing their supporters. They may be not as effective in analyzing or putting it together with their media analysis that they do. There's actually quite a gap. So I think to actually look at, yeah, and you can only do that actually for online supporters. So because a lot of the signups actually go offline in Germany, So it actually, and a lot of them are also long-time supporters, so they would generally not join because of a specific campaign, but just because they think Greenpeace in general is an effective organization. And that actually is the case with a lot of fundraising activities. So you might fundraise or try to get supporters on a very specific campaign, but I think what we found in fundraising analysis is that this may not be very sustainable, because as that campaign dies down, the interest of that person might die down again, because it might have been very focused on a specific issue, and if they see we're not working on it anymore, that they actually stop supporting us. Does that answer it a little bit? No, we haven't really seen a very strong correlation with that, really. So it's actually getting people to do something like that, like really act on something that they have become aware of through news. That's a long journey to take them on. And very often that doesn't quite work. So most of the media activities are more awareness building than they are actually empowering to do something. Although this is obviously an important first step. As long as you're not aware, you won't do anything, obviously.
Okay, on that note, thanks very much. This concludes the digital methods lecture series. We will reconvene on the 12th of January. And we are reconvening different location. I know students are creatures of habit, so I will tell you right now, please be aware that the new text is not here. Rather, it is in